Welcome back to the podcast, Conversations with Jeff Bucknam. Dr. Jeff Bucknam is the lead pastor of Teaching and Vision at Harvest Bible Chapel in Chicagoland, and I'm your co-host, Tommy Creutz, and we are going to have a conversation today with someone because we believe that everyone has a story. But before we get into that conversation, we like to do something here called the preamble ramble or the pre-ramble, where we talk about whatever it is that we want. But I'm trying to do this fast because right before we said go to start recording, Jeff said this to me. He said, "I saw the fake tree." And now, discuss. Let's talk about it.
Well, for those who haven't listened to our podcast before,
go two podcasts back.
Yeah, Tommy had mentioned that there is a conspiracy theory that he has personally come up with.
Yes.
About this tree looking,
along with others. It's a collaborative.
It's in Crystal Lake, the town in which he dwells. At the entrance of Three Oaks Recreation Area, there is a tree that is far taller than all the other trees. And it is not a tree.
Yeah, one tree is higher.
But it's not a tree. I've lived in places that have a thing called a Norfolk pine. So if you Google that, Norfolk pine.
I'm going to show my son. He's really into trees. He's going to love it. Okay.
And it looks a lot like a Norfolk pine.
In appearance or in?
In appearance. In and height. Stature, yes. So if you go to New Zealand, they have a lot of Norfolk pines.
Okay.
So this one looks like a Norfolk pine, but it's not. It's far too Christmas tree looking.
Okay.
Yep. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, like totally.
It's been manicured.
Yes.
And it's way too tall. So this is not a tree.
No. It's a fake tree.
Yes. It's got to be a cell tower. Like, that's the answer. It's got to be a cell tower.
Sure.
But it could also be a space laser.
It could be.
And it...
It could be almost anything.
Yeah.
It's so much taller than all of the other trees.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, there's like... I feel like this is the conspiracy theory that brings the other conspiracy theories together. You know what I mean? Like, birds aren't real.
I think this thing...
They have to land on the tree to get recharged.
I was going
to
say, this is controlling... It's the antenna that controls all the fake birds.
It's also could be the, you know, the 5G conspiracy theory about how it, like,
I'm dying from
controlling
it.
Yeah. Okay. So it's just a giant 5G emitter, or it possibly even could be chemtrails.
Yeah.
They're just launching them off the top. It could be a space laser.
Yeah.
That everyone's painting their house rooftops blue.
Yeah. No, I think the possibilities are endless.
They're endless.
So if you're in, again, now if you're in Crystal Lake and you're driving down, I guess it's 14 is the road there. Just look toward the if you're going north, you look to your left. If you're going south, look to your right. And you'll see it.
You'll see
it there. It's not hard to tell what it is.
But isn't it shocking, cuz you've driven past there how many times?
Several times. In fact, I've ridden my bike through there several times.
Yeah.
And it's new.
Yeah.
It's not always been there.
It's always been there.
It's not always
been there. It is. All, since you've been here, it's been there.
No.
Yes. It's a psyop. It's a government psyop.
All right.
No. Cloaking technology. See, that's they all fit together.
That's not what we're talking about.
No, it isn't. All but right. We just had to say that. I'm so happy.
Tommy, you recently were diagnosed with a heart condition.
No, that was you.
Oh.
I had a bad doctor's visit.
Oh, okay. That's right.
A bad physical, or what they call them, wellness checks now.
Okay.
So when
they told you you're not well.
Well, yeah, they had some specific words for me. I had a blood test,
mm-hmm.
which, by the way, I haven't had one in like 8 years. Turns out if you don't go to the doctor that nothing's wrong with you.
That's right.
So,
and hey, out of mind.
Then I finally went, and all of a sudden something's wrong with me.
Tommy, you're riddled with all sorts of
high numbers. Yeah. So my blood test came back. Most of it was okay. Like, nothing crazy except for my, triglycerides
or whatever. Yeah.
And my cholesterol. Well, my bad cholesterol was high. My good cholesterol was low.
Okay.
And my triglycerides were to the moon.
Okay. So this has meant that you've had to change your both diet and exercise, but mm-hmm. you told me mm-hmm. that you have your sister is a personal trainer.
Personal trainer.
In Phoenix. Mm-hmm. For all you Phoenix listeners out there.
Yeah. So she
So she's put together a program for you. Can you describe for us this program?
Yeah. So the program is basically I gave her a bunch of like things, how much I weigh, how many meals I like to eat, what types of food that I like.
How many meals you like to eat?
Like 3 meals a day.
Yeah. That's like, pretty much the norm, isn't it?
Well, some people are like, I like to eat 3 meals and 2 snacks. And I'm not much of a snacker. I'm not a big snacker guy.
Okay.
So I just said 3 meals. I don't need any snacks. Some people are like, I only do 2 meals a day because I intermittent fast. I don't know. There's a bunch of different stuff. I only eat one big meal at dinner. So she took all of those numbers, things that I like to eat, and she created this like 17-page meal plan.
17 pages.
Yeah. Half of it is like the things that it is. Honestly, I read it and I was like, this is like meal plan for dummies. Like it boils it down.
Well, I don't know what I'm going to do with this. I'll just put it over here.
Yeah. It like boils it down to the most basic, like anyone could understand it.
Okay.
And so I was like a little offended, but at the same time, most of the stuff is really helpful. So it like talks about how.
So what are you supposed to do?
So you portion your food, but you measure everything, all your types of measurements with your hand. So you don't need like a measuring cup or anything like that. So your palm is a serving of your protein, and I need 8 of those a day. So I need 8 palms of protein.
Okay.
I need a thumb of fats. Okay. So, and it's like a cup, you know.
Really? Okay.
And it's like that. So you use like your hands and your whatever to like measure your food so that you can just do it like on the fly. You don't have to do anything technical. You don't have to know anything crazy. And then it's like, it has 3 categories. It's like eat more of these, eat some of these, and eat less of these.
Yep.
And it's like all the, you know.
Yep.
So I eat more of those. I eat some of those, and I don't eat anything that's in the
less of.
In the less of.
And is that what they mean by less of? Or are they?
I think like, it's probably like you can eat some of.
Okay. So what's in the more of?
Like your lean meats.
Yeah.
So they have it broken down by.
Dude, I'm all about that lean meats.
That's protein. Yep. Carbs, fats. So they have it broken down like, you know, so.
You're really, I'm really, really invested.
Yeah,
in this.
I've been doing it for 3 weeks now.
And?
Almost a month. And I'm down like 12, 13 pounds.
Okay. So
I think that was, that came off really fast.
Is it the goal for you to lose weight?
Yeah, well, that was the other thing the doctor said. He said in the actual like wellness check, physical part, he goes, you know, things look pretty good. You need to lose some weight. Goes, the your size, your weight for the height that you are is a little disproportionate. So that's like his exact words were that. And then I was like, well, doc, this is why I don't come to you.
Exactly.
I don't need to be discouraged like that.
I need a new doctor.
Yeah, I need you to, you know, tell me that I'm looking great. No, it's been a long time coming. I have over and over and over again done like this insane weight loss. Yep. It's always come back.
So is this the newest version of your insane weight loss?
No, I'm trying to do it really slow. I think the initial burst of weight loss.
So 14 pounds or whatever it is over a period of 3 weeks, that's slow?
I think that was purely based upon I was eating fast food so much.
That's not in the more category?
And no, I know. Unfortunately, it's really hard. If you haven't been to the Crystal Lake campus, come on by. It's a great place. And right... if you look out from the parking lot, you will see a Culver's.
Yes, you will.
And it's right there every day. And it just, it says to me.
Raising Cane's is very near.
And Raising Cane's is less than 30 seconds away. But Culver's specifically, I look out the windows of our church and it says, come to me.
It does.
Come and eat.
It calls to you.
Come and have a cheese curd.
Smash this burger.
Yeah. A butter burger. A cheese curd, some ranch.
Are those not in the more category?
No. It says specifically cheese curds.
What if you wrap it in lettuce? Fried. You're still not allowed to have the butter.
I don't think so.
Isn't there an actual diet that's like, just eat butter burgers, but put lettuce on it?
That should be a thing that...
Yeah, okay.
Maybe not for people who are high triglycerides.
The bunless one, so...
I don't even know what a triglyceride is.
Do you feel like you this is the kind of eating you can do the rest of your
life? Yeah, so I'm not counting any calories right now. I might later to try and, you know, lose a little bit more, like whatever. I'm not counting any calories. It's just whole foods. It's just eating like not packaged things.
Wow.
And I feel... It's shocking, actually, how much better I feel.
Oh, good.
I've been waking up like 5:45, 6 o'clock in the morning without an alarm.
Wow.
Just like awake and ready to go. And I'm, that's never been true of me. And I feel like
that sounds like a sickness to me.
Yeah. I'm sick. Something's wrong. I have something else happening now. No, it's been, I feel energized. I mean, I've been like really sore for the past couple of weeks because I've been working out
at
the gym, which has been fun.
And you're a workout guy. You're a lifting of the weights type.
So that's the other thing that my sister gave me was
a weightlifting
on an app. And she basically, it's like the most cruise control. I don't have to think about anything. She puts the whole workout in there for me, schedules it, and I just go and click start workout. And then I mean, I have to do the workout, but like does all the planning. She takes all the guesswork out of it.
Say do the workout, I mean, she doesn't know, right?
Like you. That's can, true. You can technically, it, I, could. I could. Like, I could.
Whatever.
I could game it. Like, I could game it.
It's like when the Apple Watch tells you haven't stood enough today.
Yeah.
And you just start shaking your hand.
Just do this.
Enough. And it's like, hey, stood up.
I don't have that problem. I got Garmin. Yeah. No. It's been good.
So
it's
Tommy, good. this is going to guarantee a long life for you.
Well, here, yes. Hopefully. I mean, I don't know. Maybe I'm just one of those people with high. I've talked to a bunch of people about this now. And apparently there are some people who just like genetically have high cholesterol, high triglycerides.
Yep.
So maybe that's me.
There are people listening to us right now who will show you things on the internet that say that actually you should have all the triglycerides in the world.
Mm.
That's like a thing now.
Yeah. I don't even know what a triglyceride is. Can anyone tell? Do you know what a triglyceride is?
I know there are three of them, but that's it. So
there's three glycerides.
Yeah.
Yeah.
When
they come together,
I'm partial to the monoglyceride myself.
Yeah, when they come together, it's like almost like a Power Rangers. What's the name of that? Voltron. That's not that. There's a different. They come together and they're a bad guy though, for your body. I don't know what they are.
Tommy, let me just say I'm thankful that you're going to be a healthy guy for a long time.
Yeah,
it's nice to have you around.
I have to stick through it. Keep me honest. I have to stick through it through the winter. That's my typical falling off point. I've never made it through the winter.
No cheat days. You're not going to go to Culver's for a cheat day.
No, I think I will.
Okay.
Yeah.
And when you go to the cheat day, are you actually going to go to Culver's and be like, right, I want to have a triple butter burger.
Yeah, I still want
to
live my life.
I would like to have the largest custard that you've got.
Yeah, give me
and
the...
And I would like...
I will go on a day where the flavor of the day is something actually good.
Yeah. That you're going to go to that one where they make the triple butter burger with the cheese curd on top, the mother of all cheese curds on top of it. That's... I know. It's a sandwich that they make.
Can I tell you the most underwhelming thing about Culver's? So we were driving up to Wisconsin Dells. So if you go through Madison on 94... or up towards Madison, on your way to Madison, is the world's largest Culver's. And you can see it from the road.
Okay.
I was so excited when I saw the sign that said world's largest. I was like, guys, we have to stop at this and go to it.
And when you got in?
No, you could see it.
Yeah, but once you got in,
was it underwhelming? Barely bigger than the one.
Oh, see.
It's like a square foot bigger, maybe. And I'm like, what is this? It's such a letdown. Why would you say the world's largest? Because
it has a bay window. Yeah, right? They put a garage on it.
Maybe it has a basement and I just didn't know about it. I don't know. It was so underwhelming. Anyway, love Culver's. Can't wait to have my cheat meal there.
Speaking of cheat meals.
You have the best segues of all time. We are going to have a conversation, and you guys could talk about your favorite cheat meals, or not, whatever it is that you guys have a conversation about, because we believe everyone has a story. You're going to have a conversation with Rebekah Callahan and you're going to dive into her story, and we're going to get into that right now. Let's go. Culver's.
Sitting here with Rebekah Callahan. Rebekah, what's your maiden name?
You're gonna laugh.
Whoa, that's a weird last name.
No, Dudash.
Dudash.
Yep.
Rebekah Dudash.
That was me. I mean, it still is. I just don't go by that name anymore.
But do you do it like on social media?
Nope.
You know, some people do that. They'll put their maiden name so that they can
keep in touch with the people from their previous life. No, no, thank you.
I don't want to talk to any of those people.
Right.
Where are you from?
That's a loaded question. I'm from everywhere.
But it's that's not true. You were born somewhere and then you kind of grew up somewhere.
I'm technically from Alabama.
Really? What?
I know. Isn't that weird? That's where I was born.
Where in Alabama?
Fort Rucker.
That's amazing.
Yeah.
So were you, but you moved around a lot.
Yeah. So I say I'm from everywhere because my dad was in the Army.
Okay.
So we moved every 3 years until.
What's that like,
I moved here when I was 17. And so I guess I'm more from here than anywhere else.
When you are in an Army family, for those of us who are not in it, you know, people talk about Army brats or they talk about like, what, when you reflect on your upbringing, what were the blessings of that life and what were the not blessings of that life? I mean, I would think starting over again all the time.
That could be the entire conversation.
Okay.
I want you to know, like,
well,
there's so many blessings and not blessings. I think, okay, the major blessing is I have 4 siblings and to this day, we're still each other's closest friends. So, cause we always had each other. We moved and we made new friends.
What kinds of siblings are we talking
about
here?
I have 3 sisters and a brother.
Okay.
And I'm the middle finger.
Okay.
I'm number 3 out of 5.
Like the genuine middle
I'm
child.
I'm the actual middle child. Yes. And I embody all that a middle child is traditionally.
And how much older than you is your next oldest?
She is 4 years.
And then how much younger than you is your
3 years.
Okay, so.
So there's 16 years between my brother and who is the oldest and my youngest sibling.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow. Was the youngest sibling like really late?
I think my mom was 40 or just about to turn 40.
Oh, wow.
So she had my brother when she was, 1966? 22.
Yeah.
And then 23. I don't remember. I was there.
Yeah, yeah.
I don't know. I think she was almost 40.
Okay.
Yeah. I don't think any of us were planned.
So you had, I'm a large swath.
Yes.
5 kids.
Yep.
You're the middle.
Mm-hmm.
And you guys all, but because the age ranges were quite broad, not everybody was always home.
Let's see. When my brother joined the Army when he was 19, I was 9.
Got it.
Yeah, I think, I'm trying to remember. And we were very close.
Has everybody joined the Army?
Just my brother.
Just the oldest.
Mm-hmm.
So tell me what the blessings are, though, of growing up.
So we are our own little unit. That mm-hmm. was awesome. We got to see a lot of the world.
So list off the places that you...
It's not super exciting. Don't get, you know...
It's more exciting than a lot of people.
Born in Alabama. Then when I was 6 months old, we moved to Germany.
Where?
At that time, it was Heidelberg.
Okay.
Landstuhl was the name of the base, which is in the Heidelberg area. And then when I was 3, we moved to Maryland in Fort Detrick, which is in Frederick, Maryland.
Okay.
And then I want to say 4 years after that, we moved back to Germany to, we lived in a little town called Rupertsweiler. Mm-hmm. We lived on the economy. But my dad was stationed at a base called Permisens.
Okay.
Which is not probably close to anything that you are familiar with. It's in the Rhineland Fault, so it was really very close to France. Then when I was 10,
yeah.
We moved back to Maryland, back to same Frederick. But by that time, my dad had retired from the Army and took a job.
Okay.
So we lived in Frederick again for 3 years, and then this is a source of contention with me. My parents had promised, oh, no, we're not moving anymore.
Yeah.
But they didn't keep the promise. And I can say that now because they're both gone. We moved 3 years later to Ohio, Medina, Ohio, which is just outside of Akron.
Okay.
And then when I was 17, I came here to Moody.
And since then, you've lived in Chicagoland.
my husband and I had a 4-year hiatus in Texas.
Where in Texas?
We lived in...
You can't remember?
Well, because we moved, like in 4 years, we moved, I think, 3 times.
Oh, my word.
We started in Irving.
Dallas area?
No, we started in, where did we start?
I don't know.
No, we started in Arlington.
Yep, Dallas area.
We started in Arlington, because my husband had been there for a little while in high school. So we moved to Arlington, then we moved to Irving, then we moved to Watauga. Mm-hmm. Have you heard of that?
No.
That's more Fort Worth than Dallas. Yep. So.
Okay.
And then we moved back here.
Okay.
So, yeah.
So when you're growing up and you have that many homes.
Yeah.
So you're your own little group. That was a blessing that you were your own little group.
For sure. That's probably the blessing.
Did you like getting to try new things?
Looking back now. Yeah, for sure. Like different foods and getting to know all kinds of different people from different walks of life. Cause it's an army. And
has it made you more, hospitable to people?
I don't know.
Like if you see somebody who's new, are you kind of drawn to them? Oh
yeah, for sure. Yeah, I was the child and I was the one in our family who was like, oh no, we're going to go down the street and find someone. I remember ringing someone's doorbell who had just moved in when I was probably 8 or 9 and the whole family came to the door and I'm looking, so I want to talk to, and I like finding a child who looks like my age, that person. And so she and I became really good friends for like the couple of years that we lived on the same street. Yep. I was always the one who was dragging my sister to
go meet some other people.
Like, let's go here. Let's go there. Let's do that. So yeah, I don't think I had ever looked at it like that, but I probably am that way probably as a result of that. Yeah.
I think about my kids and the fact that they've had to move a few places, and that has made them very aware of those in the room who are new.
Right.
And, or who are sitting on the outside. They're very sensitive to somebody who might be sitting alone.
Yeah.
Or whatever. And they just feel drawn to them.
Yeah.
There's hard parts about it though, when you move around that much as well, do you just feel like you're kind of like rootless?
I did for a long time. And I feel like having been here in Chicago now for 35 years, I feel more like this is, like in the physical place, this is where my roots kind of are now.
Right.
It's really, I get itchy to move quite often.
Even now?
Oh yeah. We've been sometimes people irritate you and you just want to move away.
Yeah.
But like to find a new adventure, find a new house. We've been in the same house for 18 years and I'm like, I need something new. Hmm. So, you know,
do you recognize that though as kind of a product of your upbringing, or do you just,
I don't know. I don't know if it's like, how, you know,
yeah,
innate in me, or if that was kind of, I actually should probably ask my siblings if they feel the same, because they've all kind of lived in the same place for a long time too. Mm.
So since you grew up, they've all lived in the same location.
Where they each live, they each have lived there for a long period of time.
Yeah.
Yeah. Nobody lives close to each other.
What'd your dad do in the army?
He was in the medical maintenance corps.
Okay.
So he started, with like doing x-ray tech stuff and then kind of moved up the ranks. And when he retired, he was in charge of all the medical equipment in Europe. So,
oh, wow.
He had some adventures. He took the first CT.
Yep.
Machine. Yeah. I don't know what it's called. During the that Desert Shield, Desert Storm. So yeah, he was in 90s. Saudi Arabia delivering that.
And, oh, wow.
Yeah. So kind of a medical thing. That's how he and my mom met. She was also in the medical corps and they found each other, got married.
Both in the military. They were both together in the military, get married and they start having kids.
Yep.
And you guys are dragged all over the countryside. What kinds of things were you into when you were a kid?
Kind of things. I don't know.
If we met Rebekah when she was young, what would Rebekah
probably
be doing?
The same things I'm doing now.
All right,
a lot of reading
now?
And a lot of learning and a lot of, you know,
reading,
listening. And yeah.
Do you always have a book with you?
I don't usually have a, well, that's not true. Cause I have my iPad now. I try to do things on my iPad just to be more efficient. So yeah.
What do you read?
I usually have a book next to my bed. I usually have a book on my iPad. I'm always usually listening to a podcast.
Okay. What's your favorite podcast? The answer is Conversations with Jeff Bucknam.
I guess that would be the right answer, but
right.
I go back and forth between like health and wellness podcasts
okay.
and spiritual maturity podcasts. And then there's the Holy Post.
The Holy Post.
Yeah.
And what is that?
You've never heard of the Holy Post?
I have now.
Oh my goodness. It's Phil Vischer and Sky Gitani's.
Oh yeah.
The reason I like it is because it's like challenging to the way I think.
Oh, good.
So that's one of my favorite. That's actually probably my favorite, although.
It's a good post, but you enjoy listening to the podcast.
Yeah. And that's I also good. Love Huberman Labs.
What's it was called?
Huberman Labs.
All right.
Dr. Huberman.
No. Don't know it.
Wes has given me the thumbs up.
Wes has given you a thumbs up.
And the Knowing Faith podcast with JT English and Jen Wilkin and Kyle Worley. That's okay. Becoming one of my favorites. And that doesn't challenge the way that I think, but it's really good.
Yeah. Yeah. I listen to sports podcasts.
Yeah. I'm not.
That's what I do. But
I'm not a sports.
I do it because I have to stop thinking about
other
things.
Yeah.
Or I'm up at night a lot.
Oh, shoot.
Because I think about all sorts of stuff. Yeah. Mm. So if I engaged too much with Phil Vischer, for example, who I have a lot of time to listen to. I think he's a sharp guy. I also think he's decidedly wrong on a number of levels.
But see, that's but it's very challenging to think about, like, oh.
Have you? But that's okay.
Yeah.
And I would love to
have. For the record,
I would love to have a meeting with someone like him.
Yes.
And I would love to spend time with him. And I would love for him to explain to me how Bob the Tomato became. But I also. You know, I don't share his politics and some of those things, but I have a lot of time for his explanations for them. Anyway, so you read a lot of books mm-hmm. and you do a lot of podcasts. And when you read, do you read stuff, similar stuff, like spirituality stuff? And
I try to read really only for fun.
Okay. So is it like
there's some things I'm reading that are
novels
that are not for fun. Like I don't know. I do read, like I'm reading a Paul Tripp book right now. And
Paul Tripp is a Christian author and speaker. And
yes.
Who's mostly counselor type work, mm-hmm. right?
Like pastoral ministry, pastoral support, encouragement.
Yeah, you know. Like care ministry type things.
Yeah. So.
Yeah. And what's the name of the book?
Lead.
Yes. Mm-hmm. I do know of the book.
Yeah.
What's the best book you've ever read?
Oh my goodness.
It's just the Bible. But if after that, well, I mean, God wrote it, so.
I have a weird thing where I don't read books twice.
I don't
so
either.
I don't know.
I have this weird thing where I think most books should be, most books should be articles. Most articles should be blog posts. Most blog posts should be tweets.
Okay.
But that's because I think people can be overly verbose, and especially when they write in book form, because there's an expectation that they kind of reiterate their argument over and over again. And sometimes I'm like,
that's true.
You could just give it to me in the introduction and we'd probably be fine.
You're correct. Yes.
So so it's very rare that I come across.
I don't really have a favorite book.
Give me a top few though. Like ones that come to your mind, like, okay, so this book was really important to me.
Okay. So we have a mutual friend, Kyle, who has a daughter who is my same daughter's age.
Mm-hmm.
And I gifted her a book that I read when I was their age. And this is so old and that you probably know exactly who I'm talking about, but it's a children's book, but it's
Hello God, this
Christian
is me, Margaret.
Thing. No, it was, I have to remember the exact title.
Judy Bloom.
No, it was by John White. It's by John White, The Iron Scepter.
Oh, wow. I don't know.
I have to remember. I gave it to her for her birthday because she's a voracious reader like I was.
Yeah.
And I said, you're really going to love this book. Like those I did read over and over again as a child. Okay. And they have very, it's gospel oriented themes. And it's like a sci-fi fantasy type thing in another world.
Were those the ones that you read when you were young?
I read yes. I'm trying. The title had almost come to me, but it,
But you, so when you were young, you're reading nonfiction stuff, or sorry, fiction stuff. Right. Were you like into Lord of the Rings, or did you like the Narnia Chronicles, or those sorts
we
of
loved
things?
Yep, Narnia was huge in our family, okay. So we did read those. Yeah. We have some like family lore around some of the lore mm-hmm. in some of the books.
So on like a Saturday afternoon, you had been reading,
probably. Or you know that you probably don't remember the eyewitness books.
No.
They're like these big hardback books and they're a bunch of pictures. They're sort of like picture encyclopedias.
Okay.
And they have all kinds of subjects. So you could pick any subject, you would find one. And I would love to lay down and just look at those and read them.
Oh, great. Yeah. So what did you want to do when you grew up? No desire at all. You didn't want to be like a veterinarian. You didn't want to.
I went to Moody.
Okay.
With the intent of doing whatever I want to do. I didn't know what I wanted to do, but I knew that I wanted to be a Christian whatever. Like, sure.
Be a Christian teacher, to Moody because
a Christian doctor, a Christian what? So
you wanted
go to
the
Moody.
Biblical training so that you could kind of flesh out that part of your thinking.
Yeah, and then I don't think I was probably aware enough at 17 years old to voice that, but I knew that I wanted to be a Christian something, and I knew that my training or my knowledge was lacking. Mm. So I wanted to go there. Plus I loved the city. I had visited the school. My sister went there for a year and loved it.
Before I have one last question about though, your upbringing, when you look back at your, all those years, if there was one event or two events that stick out most in your mind that were most formative for you, what were they?
That's a deep question.
It is.
Hmm.
You can choose to answer it like, I watched this movie. You can. But, I have beachheads in my head about things that happened to me mm-hmm. that were like, even today, I'm 52 years old and there are days, I ride my bike, so like on my bike, your mind just starts wandering off into things. And it's mm-hmm. pretty regular that my mind wanders back to events that happened when I was young. It's almost like they had such a...
I don't know if there's specific events. I remember living in our Fort Detrick. So I was aged probably 4 to 7. And that was probably my favorite time. Like my parents had, we were very involved in church there. Our next door neighbors, which, and this is all coming to mind probably because I've been looking through some old photos and things. And we had a next door neighbor that I spent so much time with, their family. They had 3 adult daughters and I would go over there and, you know, we had 5 kids at home. So, and I was the middle child, so lost and nobody really even knew if I was around or not. So I could go over next door to the Moravias and spend so much time with them and learn with them. And just like, I don't know, that was really my fun. Like that's a sweet memory for me is living there in Fort Detrick. I don't know. Like, I don't know if I have like a specific events or, you know, but I have periods where I remember.
Did you follow, are you Christian all these years?
I became a Christian at 4 years old. My parents were saved the year before I was born.
Oh, wow.
So you can see it in my siblings' names. My brother's name is Doug and my older sister's name is Dawn. And then I'm Rebecca and then it's Rachel and then it's Sarah.
Yeah.
So 1974 they were saved. I was born in 1975. And so then that was 79 to 82. So they were very on fire. And I think that's probably why it was a sweet time, because it was like a lot of time spent with the church, a lot of time worshiping as a family, a lot of time with the Moravias, who were also Christians, and there was just a lot of discussion, good discussion. I think probably living there and being with them, I mean, you know me a little bit, but you know one of my favorite things is like theological discussion and bantering. And
you like to think.
That's why I like the Holy Post, because it makes you think.
Yeah.
And I don't agree with a lot of the things they say, but to hear someone else's perspective.
Oh, yeah. It sharpens your mind. Like, absolutely.
It's in fact, amazing.
I would recommend such a thing. That's why you go to, that's why you go to seminary. It's why you go and you study. So you hear other viewpoints and you have, it sharpens your thinking.
So I think having my parents in that season where they were super on fire in that space was why that was so formative. Mm. And it's probably a lot why I am the way I am.
which is a good thing.
Yes. I think so. See, that's me being kind to myself.
Rebekah, you go to Moody.
Yep.
And you're there to get whatever. You're still not even sure what you want to do while you're at Moody.
Right. The plan was to go for a year. And I remember calling my mom probably 3 months in saying, I think I just want to stay. And she said, okay, we'll just do that. And I had applied very late because I didn't know what I wanted to do. I had no idea. I was working at a
restaurant.
So did you
go to Moody kind of on a whim,
I applied late and they had put me on a wait list.
Yeah.
And there, I was like, okay, fine. I'll just keep working and living life. I don't know. And I was working at a restaurant and my mom came tearing into the restaurant. You're going. And I was like, what?
Yeah.
So we literally went shopping that day, packed the car that night, left our house at 3 a.m, got to school, had class that same day.
Wow.
Like.
So that's how you got to Chicago. Yeah. And here you are. You've been here for all these years.
1992 to what's the year?
Yeah.
I don't know how many years that is. That's a lot of years.
Yeah, it is quite a few. 32. Yeah. Something like that. Yep. So you were at school. Did you meet your husband there?
Yep. A couple of years as a junior. I was a junior and he was a sophomore. And
you're really tall. Did you not ever play sports or
anything?
No. Really? Nobody said you're standing under the basket. Come here.
I think I tried playing basketball one time in middle school and was not very good.
And they were like, well, look, you've.
Well, I mean, I just did not enjoy it. I was a choir person.
Okay. Do you still sing?
I mean, I like to sing.
So
you won't find me on stage.
Why not?
I don't know. That's weird.
But you enjoy singing?
I do.
And do other people enjoy you singing?
You'd have to ask them. I don't know.
Can you carry a tune?
I don't know. I feel like you can, but doesn't everybody think that they can?
Well, yeah, American Idol would say so.
Exactly.
Would you go out for American Idol?
I stood in front of people in church who cannot carry a tune.
Yeah, but you can. So if I stood in front of you at church,
I don't know. Why don't you try it next time you're out at Elgin and then you let me know.
I was in Texas.
I'll take your honest opinion.
Last weekend, and there was this really wonderful man, older gentleman standing next to me at the church I attended, which was almost entirely young adults. But the guy next to me was this lawyer. He was he would have been easily in his 70s. And he had that warbly older gentleman voice. And it's just so lovely to hear this man singing these worship songs, which are modern,
right,
with this warbly voice. But it reminded me that, I mean, I loved it because I was like, oh, the church is for all of us, right? And to God, it's a beautiful noise. Right. To everybody else, it wasn't amazing. But you would be a little bit more amazing, I'm assuming.
I think I'm okay.
Okay.
I like singing.
That's good.
I don't know.
Do you have music on all the time?
Do I have music on all the
time?
I love music. So I love podcasts and I love music.
All right. So there's always something you're listening to.
Usually.
All right. Good. Yeah. How did you meet your husband?
In the student dining room of the Moody Bible Institute.
What was he doing?
Well, he was a friend of a boy who my roommate liked. And she didn't want to go sit at their table.
He was a friend of a boy. Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Your roommate liked.
She liked this boy who was his friend. And she said, I don't want to go over there alone. Will you come with me? I said, sure. And there he was.
And immediately you knew?
I think I whispered in her ear, he's pretty cute.
Nice.
And I think him and his friend were also talking.
And he said, she's pretty cute.
I think so. And then he asked me to the mall.
Sorry, what?
He asked me to go to the mall with him.
Is that what they did back
in 1994
at Moody?
Yep.
That was the big date.
You want to go to the mall with me? Yeah, so we went to the mall.
Did you have an Orange Julius?
No. We drove out to Stratford Square Mall in Bloomingdale. And then he asked me on an actual date.
Oh.
And then it was very impressive because he took me to the Bears home opener that year.
Wow.
Yeah.
Were you a Bears fan? Or
no.
I
couldn't care less, but it was something exciting.
Yeah.
And we had press passes and it was like,
what? How did he get a press pass?
One of his friend's mothers worked for WGN.
So, oh, wow.
Yeah.
So you guys got to hang out at Soldier Field.
Yeah, and went under into the press.
How long were you dating before you
got married? We started dating in August of 1994, and we got married in January of 97.
Okay, that's a few years.
Mm-hmm. Well, like 2.5.
Yeah.
About.
When did you know that you wanted to marry him?
I think so. We met in August, and then, you know, we're together all the time. I didn't know his last name for 3 weeks.
Is that on purpose, or you just forgot?
Well, everybody called him, his name's Larry. Uh-huh. And everybody called him Larry Love. Larry Love, Larry Love. Because, you know, it was in the 90s and the, you know, like the skater boy era.
Yeah. Was he a skater?
Not really. But it was that whole, you know,
yeah, like sure.
grunge kind of thing. So it was Larry Love. And we were out one night with some friends and him. And I said, so what's your last name? Because this was going to make or break the relationship. If I didn't like his last name, I wasn't moving forward. Because I'm not taking some weird name. I've already got Dudash as a name.
You're like... It's got to be. I'm trading up here.
Yeah, if it's not better than Dudash, I'm out. So he said his last name was Callahan. I was like, okay.
I can do that.
Yeah, let's go. So then I, you know, we spent a lot of time with his family. There was one day we were out. His aunt and uncle lived in Wheeling, and we were out there watching football. And came back to the city that night and was kind of like, I feel like we could get married. And it was like a mutual conversation of, I think this is it. So... Yeah.
That would have been lovely. It's a nice conversation to have.
It was a wonderful conversation to have.
Yeah. Yeah. And how many years have you been married?
In January, it will be 28.
Wow. That's fantastic. Congratulations.
Is that right? Or 29? January 2025, we were married in 97. 28.
Yeah. When did he lose all his hair?
Oh, gosh.
Before or after you dated him?
So...
Did you, you knew it was going though?
I know that. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, like you kind of got into it and you're like, yeah, I see where this is.
So I was 19 when we met and he was 23. And I remember being at his parents' house one day and, it was like getting thin in the back.
Yeah.
And his mom said, it's because you're wearing all those hats.
Boy, she was wrong.
Yeah. And, so it started getting thin then, but he didn't actually lose his hair until like, I've got pictures from, you know, 15 years ago where he still got most of his hair. So.
Yeah. Well, so he held on to it for a good long time then. Mm. That's great.
It's okay.
Nah, he's a good bald guy.
He is a good bald guy.
You know what I mean? Like mm-hmm. some people's heads are just misshapen and he is not a misshapen head.
Next time
head.
You see him, you should
It's not a misshapen head. No, I'm just giving you the feedback.
When he looks down, he's got a flat. You could set a cup on it.
Ooh. It's probably because his parents late. Because he wore all those hats.
I hope that's getting cut out. Poor Larry.
He knows. Larry's a really good dude. Right. So, when you graduated though, you still must had some idea as to what it is that you
no,
and you had all this training now, and you loved reading and you loved thinking,
right?
And you must at some point have thought to yourself, you know what? I actually think maybe working in ministry is something that I want to do.
Let me tell you. I'll tell you the story.
Okay.
I graduated. My major was Bible theology. They don't have that major anymore, with an emphasis on Bible. And, you know, we got engaged before I graduated. And I knew I wanted to be a mom and a wife. And I was like, well, I guess I'll just raise my kids, you know, with the knowledge of the word and in the Lord and blah, 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 which is all great. Yes. And I did, and kind of didn't really think about that for a long time. And then we were at our church in Texas, which was, Irving Bible Church.
Oh, wow. Yeah.
With Andy McQuitty, and our women's director's name was Karen Edwards.
Okay.
And she was in her 50s, probably mid 50s. And she was at DTS getting her master's, her MDiv. And I am with, I'm not even sure Grace was born yet. So I think I just had one kid and I was like,
there it is.
Yeah. And she's in her, and I'm like, I don't know. I know that it's never going to be too late, you know? Mm. So kind of didn't think about it for a while. But always kind of had that in the back of my mind. Like I'm just kind of on hiatus.
Yeah.
Raising these kids, which is very important. And, you know, we've always had them in church. We've always kind of made their relationship with the Lord our number one priority. Anyway, don't make me cry. Don't make me cry.
How many kids do you have?
Four.
Four children.
Yeah.
And ages?
25. I round up, so let me not round up this time. Okay. 25, 23, 18, 13.
Yeah.
She'll be 14 on Sunday. That's why.
Congratulations.
I could almost round up. And then we have two grandkids.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. You're a bit young for that.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I agree.
Well, I think I'm like 3 years older than you. And I don't have grandkids.
Yeah, that's okay. I remember when Jacob, my oldest, was born, I was 23. I remember,
yes,
yeah. Like literally my first thought when he was born was, I'm going to be a young grandma.
Yeah, well, you're
it's fine.
Well, your husband's also 4 years older than you, so it's a little.
Yeah, he's 5 years older than me.
Wow.
He doesn't cradle get a break. Robin. Yeah. So anyway, Karen was an inspiration, but I was young, raised my kids for a long time. And then in 2016, there's a lot to the story. But anyway, I came on staff as very part-time in Elgin in adult ministry. And then quickly, a lot of things happened. And just opportunity for ministry came. Mm-hmm. And when you're on staff at a church, you're in ministry, whether you are mm-hmm. in ministry or not, right?
Yeah.
So... I don't know. It's been a few years. And then I think it was, when was that? 3 years ago? 2 years ago? 2022, correct?
Mm-hmm.
When Grace came and started the deploy program.
Yeah.
And I remember saying literally to my boss at the time, probably 3 weeks before that was even introduced, I said to him, I think I want to go back to school and get my master's. Like,
yeah,
I think it's time. And then it was like, oh, the Lord was like, oh, here you go. So...
So you've been in the process of doing your master's degree mm-hmm. as a woman in her late 40s.
Right.
And how's that gone? Which, first of all, that's so awesome, right? No, it really is. It's remarkable. And I actually think some people, men and women, it doesn't go through their heads that would even be a possibility in some ways. And yet it really is. It really is. There are lots of ways to do it. There are lots of universities and seminaries and programs these days that allow people to do that kind of thing. And I sometimes think it would be a great blessing for the second half of their lives.
I hope I get a long second half to.
Yeah, I'm sure you will. But even if you didn't, it would still, I mean, what else? What is there anything better to study than who God is and what he's like? And
no, I think it's awesome. It's been really good. I love learning and stuff. Like, if you know me, you know that I'm always learning something and always have something I'm obsessive about to some degree. I don't know if it's, ADHD or what, but.
It's being thoughtful. And there are some people who just love to think about the world and how it ticks and not just about, the next thing. But the things behind the things.
Yeah. I'm a big person. I'm a big behind the, why is this happening?
Yeah.
Why does this work? Or how does it work?
Right.
And so that's how I also teach is, and I'm going to be kind to myself because I promised, but I sometimes think that people don't want to hear that, but that's the way I learn. And I feel like it's so much more valuable when you hear the backstory a little bit.
I actually think that people who are wired like you are gifted by God to think in ways that other people don't normally so that they can bring that to people. Most people do live just kind of moment to moment or day to day, which is a super healthy way to live, but they're not really aware of the forces that are acting on them in the world. And it takes reflective people who might be called intellectuals or they might, people who are, trying to think clearly about the society and how it's affecting us and how it's pushing us into its mold and also about scripture and what does it look like for a Christian person to live faithfully. And that those people think a bit more, we'd say deeply, but maybe at a 30,000 foot view to be able to see the forest and understand it. And usually when you're teaching and you're able to explain to people, oh, you do know that these forces, a lot of people are like, that's what I felt.
Yeah.
I didn't know that.
This is why you think the way that you think about this.
Yeah. And so I think it's a real blessing. I think it's fantastic that you're involved. First of all, that you're wired like that, and that you're also, but people like you, and I'm saying it because I'm like you, we are very hard on ourselves.
I know. Why?
I don't know.
I don't know why either.
But we are.
Mm-hmm. See, so I when need you to say be kind being to kind myself.
Well, yeah. I think I've shared once or twice before that when I first kind of realized that I was, well, when I was diagnosed with depressive disorder years ago, my psychiatrist, who I'd never, if you had told me I was going to go to a psychiatrist, I would have told you, whatever.
You're crazy.
They're a bunch of quacks. Mm-hmm. Right? Apparently I was crazy. Still am. That's why I was a psychiatrist. And so he remember him telling me that if you ever treated anybody else the way that you treat you, mm-hmm. that you'd be arrested. And I was like, oh, yeah, that's probably kind of true. That's true. He said, nobody despises nobody acts in such despicable ways toward themselves like you're acting toward yourself and say the things they say about yourself. But I'm not alone in that. And I think sometimes people who are super reflective, they have high standards for themselves. They have high expectations for the world, for the way that things happen. And we're pretty regularly let down. Mm-hmm. And there's been a long history of people like that. I mean, some of the great preachers in history, quite honestly, have had that kind of melancholy because they do think deeply about it. And so it's not abnormal, but it also, meaning that there's a lot of people who have done it, but it is abnormal in the sense that it's not really what God wants from us.
One of the things, are you fascinated with history?
Yeah. Yeah, and how things work together and why something happens this way. And then I get really reflective about like what, so this event happened and there's these six contributing factors to it. And then I start thinking theologically about the providence that's involved in that. Mm-hmm. And like I did one of my degrees when I was in, I was double major in history and communications when I was in college. And one of in history, I did a lot of World War II stuff. Mm-hmm. So I got way into thinking about, you know, the Nazis and they did. And when you start studying the life of Hitler, for example, like there were three or four times where he should have died, mm-hmm. like legit should have died. He just happened to be standing in a particular place on a, you know, behind a table that fell over and the bomb went off and other people died in the room, but he didn't.
Right.
Or a bomb that was put on a plane. Actually, Dietrich Bonhoeffer was part of that. They put it on a plane and it just didn't, it went off, but it didn't, the trigger system didn't work somehow. It just fluky didn't work. And now as a Christian, I'm like, so that's total providence.
Yeah,
and then
you have to believe in the providence.
Right. And then you're like, wait a minute, Lord, you could have taken this guy out and you didn't do that. Like, and how many people died after that? And then that creates all sorts of, so I'm that guy who goes down this dumb rabbit hole and then gets really like,
see, it's very hard for me to just not start talking about all that.
Because it's good. But that's a good thing.
I'm restraining.
It's a good thing to be able to talk about those matters and to think about it. So you should be encouraged, though, that's a gift that's given you for the benefit of others.
Okay.
Well,
I will.
I know you don't believe me.
No,
you're so
you probably
used to
feel
telling
the same way that I feel like a lot of people don't understand me.
No, I agree. Because I think too much and I feel like I always share too much information.
Yes.
And then I'm sorry.
When somebody appreciates it, it's kind of like,
No, you should.
What's going on here?
But you should. Yeah. It is a blessing to people. They don't always, they sometimes look at us like we're a little weird because we are thinking and asking questions that nobody else in the room is kind of asking, or very few people in the room are asking. And yet they're questions that are necessary, right?
They're I've kind of learned to not.
Don't do.
To just kind of be quiet.
Stop it, Rebecca.
No,
you should ask it.
I've gotten into trouble for asking too many questions.
You think so. But those. There are people around who desperately need you to ask those questions. To be honest with you, I think there might be a piece of a prophetic gifting. And please, when I say that, I'm not saying like telling the future and stuff like that. I just think that you know, to think deeply about certain things. Maybe that's the wrong phrase for it. Maybe the prophetic gifting is not the right one, but prophets are usually not liked because they say things and ask things that are not necessarily what everybody wants because they, you know, they stir the pot.
What I struggle with is how much am I doing it intentionally out of a sinful place, or how much am I doing it where I just can't help it and I have to?
We're the same person. You're laughing, like, but even like, that, even that, like, the fact that you're thinking.
I said this to Stephanie this morning. I said, there's times where something is happening and I know, and I just like, out of my pride, I'm poking them.
Yeah.
But then there's most often I don't mean to do it, but they still feel the poke.
Yeah.
You know, but there's times where I'm meaning to poke you because you're just so arrogant.
Yeah.
And it's like,
yeah.
And so that's what I'm trying to work on is the,
I know, but even the fact that you're thinking through the tension in that is shows the gifting, mm-hmm. right? That kind of wiring.
Well, thank you for saying that. I didn't think about that that way before.
It is. Like a lot of gifts for a lot of people, it can also be a bit of a plague because your mind doesn't shut up and it just keeps going and you kind of feel voracious at times. Like you just want to know more and you just want to learn more. And you know, a good holiday, people always like, well, you should take a break. And you're like, I hate it. Like, you go and sit around and don't do anything or think about anything. You're like, that sounds like the worst break.
Well, that's why I'm always reading.
Yeah.
There's always something.
Yeah, there's always something new to learn and always something
and
new.
And I don't like going on vacation if there's no place to go explore or see.
So in 5 years, 10 years, what do you hope the Lord leads you into? What do you want? Like, what would you love to do?
Oh,
do you care?
My goodness. I do care. I don't, but this is the way I've been always is I'm in trying to do more of exactly what's in front of me now and just focus on that instead of extrapolating out the future. Cause I don't have any say over that, but I'm super excited about being in the MDiv program. I wish they had a ministry of theology. Mm. Option, but they don't, but that's fine.
You're doing, you are the, basically the women's ministry director role here in,
Elgin.
At the Elgin campus. Mm-hmm. So for those of you who are listening, who wonder what Rebekah is actively involved in right now, that takes up a chunk of your time.
Yep. I do that part-time and my official title is women's ministry resident. Mm-hmm. And I am on staff part-time and then the other part of the part-time, whatever that looks like, is spent on schoolwork. So it's a lot of reading and writing papers and all that kind of stuff. And I went into it without any expectations, kind of, I don't know what the future holds because this is, I mean, it's weird and you probably know this, but when I started, I was working for IT, which there's a whole story about how I ended up there and
well, you're very gifted, so you end up everywhere.
Yeah, that's a story for another time. But I said I want to do it because I don't know what the future is. I know that I feel like I was called to ministry way back in the 90s and have just the circumstances haven't been right. And I said I want to have that degree so that I am fully equipped for whatever the Lord calls me into as fully equipped as I can be, even though you don't need you. And I hope that if anybody's listening, that they are listening, that you don't need a seminary degree to be in ministry.
Yeah.
So,
but it also can be really helpful.
One of our former staff members, Dr. Van Lanningham,
current elder
has been a great source of encouragement and sort of mentoring to me. And he said to me one time during one of our Greek classes, and he said, you just need to keep going because it's especially important for you as a woman to do this. So yeah, there's a lot.
Well, I'm glad you're doing it.
Thank you.
I really am. Even when I first met you, Rebekah, people need to affirm you more, I think. So I'm trying to affirm you. Thanks, and I want you to know that,
Thank you, Jeff.
I see the gifting and I see the fact that you're trying to fan that gift into a flame is really encouraging to me to see somebody your age, you're a grandma. You're the, I know.
I do not. Okay.
You're the theological nana.
I know
nana,
that I'm going to be 50 next year, but I feel literally, I feel probably 32.
Oh, of course. But theological nana, that's the name of your new podcast.
That's not a bad idea.
Yeah. There you go. It's been great talking to you. Thank you very much for spending the time with me. Oh, I wanted to do a rapid fire round really quickly.
Okay.
Okay. Just a few quick questions. Do you speak German?
Theoretically.
That makes no sense.
I lived in Germany and took 4 years of German in high school, had one college semester. I can understand a lot of German. I can't speak it really well. Probably if I lived there again and were living there, I probably would be able to.
Which one of your kids would you like to go out to a movie with most?
No, none of my children will listen to this, right? Probably not.
I'm going to ask you questions about other things that you'd, other kids, you know, like some, would you like to go and just hang out?
Probably Grace, because we have a lot of mutual interests. She's my 23-year-old.
Okay. Which one would you want to go to an athletic event with?
I would not like to
Which
go to
one
an
would you
athletic
like to
event?
Throw axes with?
Oh, gosh. All these things I don't like to do. Axes.
Doesn't matter.
Probably,
you have to go throw axes.
Okay, let's do it with Jacob.
Okay.
Why? Yeah. I don't know.
Because he seems like an axe throwing type. Well, if you were going to go shoot a bunch of guns, which one of your children would you go
with? For sure, Jacob. He's the only gun owner currently in our household. And he's the only one who's ever gone axe throwing. So that's why I would go with him. And he's very careful.
Which one would you go with to a poetry reading?
I would not, and neither would any of my kids.
Really? You wouldn't go to a poetry reading with any of your kids?
If you had to sit at a coffee shop.
No, if you had to go to Waffle House and you had to be there for 4 hours and you had to eat a waffle, had to eat like six waffles the whole time.
I love Waffle House.
Which one of your
know.
Kids would you want with you?
Caleb.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. Which one of your kids could you beat in a race? 100 meters. All right.
Maybe Sarah.
Which one of you win a arm wrestling competition with?
Sarah. She's the only one. She's 14. Well, she's 13.
All right. This is good.
Her arm is like.
Yeah, she's weak.
No, she's very strong.
Just in other ways.
That's right.
That's great. All right. Thanks so much, Rebekah.
I've got such a small head.
All right. Take care.